there's someone out there who can understand and who's feeling the same way as me.
Hello, hello, hello.
Move that out of the way. We don't need that.
What do we need? What do we need? I don't need that. Need these guys. Right, our old friends. And then where's my, measuring tape. Alright. Okay. This one's gonna get entertaining because right now this canvas is large enough that it's the largest one I've done since I started streaming on Twitch. And the problem that I'm running into, damn, I almost sound walking like, well, the problem I'm running into, no, anyway, is that to try to keep it in camera sight fucks with the microphone. To rearrange it could screw things up royally. So, I'm not sure how we're going to pull this off. I may be playing with these cameras for the next few days. So, I apologize if, like, you're like, hey, I'm used to this one view, and then it's like, fuck everywhere else. I might try to push the canvas back. But if I do, see, right now it's touching the back end of my old drawing desk, or the foot of it. So, it's got to go over the foot, so it's got to go farther back than just, like, slightly. It's going to have to go a big back. And that would open up the microphone a little better, because right now it's, like, right here at the clock. It's literally hitting the canvas. And once we start throwing paint up, that ain't going to work at all. Let's tell you a little bit about what we're working on. This painting is going to be, actually, of my friend Lou's barn and house. It's actually out in an area where I used to stomp around quite often, which made me laugh because when I went to take the picture, it was pouring. Like, it's just absolute shit weather. And every time I went out there to take pictures for paintings, when I was going to school, the weather was absolute garbage every time. The best I ever had, I think, one day was like partly cloudy with the threat of rain. And the sun did break for a little bit. Thank God it was at the point when my buddy Davin had gone out with me. And we were in a clearing checking for ticks. So the sun cleared out nice enough so that we could actually see the ticks that were on us. And we were able to pick them off before they decided to bite in and have some fun. Some other stuff regarding this piece. We're going to get a little creative on certain elements. As I said, the weather's garbage, but does anybody ever really want a painting of their house and, you know, and their land or whatever with crappy weather? So, we're going to kind of do some editing a little bit. I actually had to do some little Photoshop editing just to kind of fill out what I was going to need out of this piece. And actually, that's causing a little bit of a complication, too, because the halfway point of the photo is not the actual halfway point needed for the painting. Allow me to explain once I get this halfway point done. And have it in a nice composition. My camera took it at 2 watts. Part of the house, we lost part of the barn. No matter how I cut it. So what I did was, got it out to 35 to, you know, or how did I do it actually? I think I did it up to 28 and screwed around with it. So part of it, I added stuff to the top, I added stuff to the bottom. So we got like a little extra roadway at the bottom, a little extra sky. If you see my style, you know that actually just gives you more room to play. So that's kind of groovy for me. I don't have to worry about that. I did one little shitty adjustment, just threw in the top of the telephone pole there. That had another picture, just tossed it on there just so I know, okay, that's about what will be visible. And I did a real shitty job just making sure, you know, the bottom of the picture was flushed out at least with the extra roadway that I was putting in. The aspect ratio, kind of the distance between the barn and the house, might be fudged a little. We might make the barn look a little bigger or something just so it gets a little more, you know, quality time there. And nobody's here. But I'm still going to stay because I'm a fucking asshole. Gotta do it a couple spots. But, I was lost on that. I don't remember the last one I thought there was. Okay, come on, stay up with me, buddy. I think you're a little off. We're going to go off on that one. So we're going to go back that way a little bit. Okay, that works. So we're going to have some, like I said, some creative editing on the aspect ratios. Well, that's interesting. I always find those little tangents very interesting. It's like a perfect tangent at the back end of the truck here. I haven't loaded the picture up to Imgur, whatever the fuck you, however you pronounce it. Because I was kind of rushing this today. We were, we had tickets to the Phillies. So we had to get out of the house. And so I was like, okay, quick, just download it and quick find it. Now quick, you know, everything. So, and then I had to get the studio ready. So it's not quite gonna be up for Unger. Yeah. Width is fine, but we're gonna wanna. Oh, I was an asshole. Jesus Christ. Was I that stupid? I was. I put the halfway point. I never put the halfway, like the quarter points. Oh, look at that. And I just up with the window. That's interesting. This is going to make some interesting things happen in the painting. That doesn't sound like it'd be very interesting, but actually, when you get these weird, you know, I've said like tangents between the elements here, like I said, of where I'm measuring. Not that my grid ever should still be visible after the painting goes, you know, on top of it. But on a compositional level, that makes little tricks with your brain. And that's kind of cool. Like, if you guys aren't familiar with the term, it's called the robust square. And I'll break out a sketch or like my notebook real quick to show it, because it's a lot easier to show than it is to explain. Alright. And mind you, this is not going to be perfect. This is just going to give you a kind of an idea. So if you have a canvas, no matter what really size it is, but in a rectangular form, okay? Not entirely unlike this painting. The theory of the robust square is basically, you have, you know, however long this is. It's about 1 3/4, whatever. Okay, I'm just going to kind of roughly hold my hand here. If I do that, and I'm going to do it this way too. That's basically considered like you would want to put main elements along these two lines. Okay? So you get this, it's a compositional element, like, okay, this side's kind of one thing, yeah, so you got two squares, you know, like, from here to here, and from here to here, right? So you have that idea. And a lot of older compositions would rely on this, usually involving two, not just the square, but maybe the diagonals of the said square. So you might see an old painting, especially like, you know, Renaissance Romantic period paintings. I'm doing it, and I don't know if you guys can even see it with that shitty little camera. But so you had something like that, okay, going on. You would find major elements along some of those tangents, along with the main line. There's a relatively famous Franklin. I mean, he's famous around here like crazy now, and he's up there with the fucking kite and everything. And in that, you can actually watch the string of the kite follow along that path of one of the diagonals. Now, me personally, I really do that again. By just life, unfortunately, to paint more from photos than from life itself. I still very much consider myself more of an impressionist, and I try to think like a plein air painting, like a painter. So I'm much more in tune with the idea of literally having a canvas, running outside with it, throwing a canvas, on an easel or whatever real quick, and trying to get my shit down, you know, as it was in front of me. I said I'm a little slower, unfortunately, this one is the one that like had everything was like in a weird tangent. That's right. That's really cool. So as I do these lines, hopefully you guys will see some of these. I'll hold it up. But it's gonna make some interesting set elements that'll look at that, it wraps up the barn too. Ah, this one's gonna be, see, now this is something too now. Thinking instinctively, this is how it all happened. Like, you know what I mean? Like, my brain knows historic elements of, art history and how they would compose paintings. And so, I think nowadays, I just instinctively do it. You know, like, I may look at, as I said, go out to a field. Here's a field, you know, fuck, I want to paint that. And I may go out there, even if I'm able to do it plein air, or if I take a photo, whatever. I think I just automatically go, okay, like, this is where I want the composition, like, right here. And I'll do it like that, and I think you'll notice stuff like that starts happening. Oh, shit. Put my triangle away, I need them. So, again, I'm going to kind of go with my whole theory, plan, plot, evil method for this channel. Not that anybody's viewing. But, and I'm out of focus again, aren't I? That looks good. All right. Which is, again, an idea that, you know, maybe someone's going to come on here and paint, and they're not going to paint like me at all. And that's fucking groovy, and I encourage that. Much as I encourage profanity in small humans. No, you people might call them children. Whatever. Now, meanwhile, everybody who was like a parent at my for my son's camping trip or whatever, fifth grade camping trip, they're like, "That's where he learned the words." No, the kids all know them. Anyway. Point should be there. But as I was trying to say, oh shit. Hold on. proposition, do it. If you just want to kind of do a plein air idea, fucking do it. Yeah. All right, so 35's half is 17 and a half, right? I mean, 8 3/4, right? And then, it's what, 25 down? Or 28, it's 28 down, right? Yeah, that's what it was, it's 28 inches, so. That one's easy. 14, 14, 21. So that's why I'm trying to explain that. So you guys can see, I keep every time I touch it, it's just right into the canvas. So we're gonna run into some issues here. I'm gonna have to figure something out. Okay, so. Six and a quarter, right? Anybody want to do my math for me? 26 and a quarter, that's right, right? 8 3/4, 17 and a half, and 26 and 3/4, right? Someone double check? 26 and a quarter. 17 and a half. This falls under a big one. And it's going to be a little off because to fit the canvas and the mic and the cameras where I need them to make this all sort of work for now. I can't be putting my halfway point of the canvas like centered to the easel. Pain in the ass to do this right. So, everybody bear with me on this one as much as you can. But this is when this, like, really kind of comes in important to make sure that, like, I should almost do another one, but I'm not going to. Just sort of make sure these are sort of lining up right. Again, I don't worry too much, but I like to be close. Yeah. I should do it like this, shouldn't I? So it's tough being a southpaw to get these sides. But if I kind of like gives me a little bit of a line, if I can get that right angle first. It is funny. Now I'm going to share the story. Because nobody's watching, so who do I care? It's a bit embarrassing to me. I was confused as to who was actually texting me regarding this commission. And I think in the last stream, you might notice that I'm talking about drawing the barn. I keep referring to my friend Jeff. Now, my friend Jeff has a barn, a nice house and everything, that he had also asked me a while back about drawing. But it kind of, the conversation sort of stopped because it was at the time when I just started painting again, and at that time, like, I really wasn't going to be taking anybody's commissions. I just wanted to do what I wanted to do as a much more mental health standpoint. And about the same time, that happened. My friend Lou, who was, neighbor growing up, my parents' house and everything, he bought a home out in West Grove, and it too has a barn, a nice house and everything. And I was talking to him about doing it too, and again, so, sort of a similar thing, like, dude, I just, not right now, I just can't take commissions now, you know, kind of thing. I said I'd love to go up there and do something. I thought my canvas was fraying. Oh, shit. That almost caused... Okay. I'm going to need a moment. Whew. That scared the shit out of me, man. I thought the canvas had a hole in it or something. Jesus Christ. Oh, that would have set us back another week. Oh, man. All right. Whew. Okay. Anyway. So, two guys that both had... within a relatively close distance of each other, bought a home with barn, you know, a barn and a house. At the same time, we're talking, like I said, and this was a while back. I had both numbers in my old phone. And I should say my old, old phone. That is, the phone shattered on the basement floor here. In my house when I was losing a game I know I should have easily won in, might have been Marvel Puzzle Quest. I think it was Marvel Puzzle Quest. So I shattered the phone. So the only contacts I got back were those that were in the cloud. And I didn't have everybody in the cloud. So what ended up happening is I started getting these text messages about doing this commission, and I didn't know who I was talking to. I knew it was one of them, and it wasn't until I got the address, which was out in West Grove, I went, oh, wait, it's like, and even that at first, I was like, did Jeff move to West Grove? Because he's the one, the most recent one I actually spoke to about it. And so that's why I was like, what the fuck? Like, and then I figured out. Well, this is Lou's barn, so if you watch the old drawing, keep calling Jeff's, and that's wrong. And again, that partially falls under the I'm a moron and I've shattered my phone over a stupid fucking game. And I'm a moron who nowadays gets easily confused up here. So it is what it is. Alright, that went relatively easily for the... I'm trying a little different. Like, if you've ever seen me start a canvas before, 9 times out of 10, I'm just running back and forth to the pencil sharpener. But the wire here is a lot more precarious, and I don't know why. I thought I had it in a better place, but and that I could get by easily, but maybe it's because the canvas was closer or smaller. I don't know. I feel like I gotta like duck under it, and I keep pulling it down. So also, if you get the action cam, we're falling. I apologize. But I sharpened like 4 pencils, so I could try to do this a little easier. What we can see here to start. I like to find like the easiest element to just grab. And it looks to me like it's probably our road. Because our road, it's close to here, like maybe about there to start. And it goes down here. All right. It's relatively straight, but keep in mind we're kind of out in the... It's not the sticks anymore. God knows when I was out there, you know, what, 18 years ago, 19 years ago, taking photos and shit, it was the sticks. It was... There went shit around there for miles sometimes. So I'm going to try to keep it sort of a straight road, but... Yeah, the canvas is going to bend on me. There's going to be little elements that we just want to sort of try to line it up to from there to there. Try to figure out, like, when we look at our lines here, kind of how far up it goes. Chicks dig it. We're going to manipulate it. We're going to have to play around. Because, like, yeah, I'm a little off one way or the other. That's pretty close. Let me see if it will, like, slide this down a little. It's up a little. You know what I mean? See, that's the nice thing about... Because this painting, like I said, because the photo I took doesn't quite match up with the proportions we needed to get the main subject right, we can kind of fuck around up and down. Doesn't necessarily matter. Like, if the road comes up a little high here, no big deal. We're going to be able to kind of manipulate it, you know, on the back end. Yeah. And if I were plein air doing this, I guarantee you right now I don't have a straight edge. Right, this one. Now I praise these kneaded erasers. Now keep in mind this one's probably a good 10 years old. Getting a little stiff. It's getting a little to its edge. Now, the grassy area, the grassy knoll, if you will, or if you don't, that's fine too. It was in the hip scene. Call it the knoll. No, they don't. Sorry, I get paranoid sometimes when I don't, like, see my the actual dashboard, and I'm like, wait, did I actually trigger it to go live? Now you guys will find out why I'm a fucking lefty, because look at this. I can't even do a... close to a straight line, right? That's all right. This is grassy area, you know what I mean? We're going to be okay here. It actually bumps up here near the middle a little bit, then slides back down a bit. Very interesting, but stupid. I won't lie, I'm debating what to do with the power lines. Part of me doesn't want to put them in there. I don't like power lines. They really bother me. And it's just not like... It's just, as an artist, I look at them, and they just sort of piss me off. Because they're always fucking in the way, in the wrong place for a good commission. You know what I mean? Well, not just for a good commission, but good layout. No matter how you're going to do an area like this nowadays, you got fucking power lines right in the fucking middle of the thing, and it pisses me off. So I'm debating what I'm doing regarding that still. That's going to be an element, a lot like cat whiskers and shit. That stays to the end. I may just do the damn telephone pole. You know what I mean? And maybe one or two, but not leave all these goddamn lines, because they're driving me nuts. I look at them, and like they're cutting right in front of the barn, they're cutting in front of the house. It's like, no. I want you to see the house, I want you to see the barn. By the time this is all done, you know? Slightly right-handed, just so I'm not running your guys' faces when I'm... Okay, our tree is just a little bit in. Maybe like that and that. Right. Telephone pole is almost halfway. Perfect. That element. And it's just a little shyer of the tree trunk's width. Kind of goes right about there.
Right.
On a hill. Gotta view, bump this up a little bit. I gotta see whether or not you can actually see. Yeah, I'm out of focus. I'm trying to focus it when I'm not even looking at the live shot. It's a little better. It'll keep jumping off. Sorry, I like my editor. I like it to be like live up. And I know, like I said, the audio is going to be shit this episode until I figure out how I can rearrange this microphone. Because this one's really in the way now. And once I start putting paint up, we're done with this. This won't work. Alright, the barn. And like I said, I don't think it's grounded anymore. Touched it earlier and it was like, bzz. I'm like, nah, that's not good. Alright, so the barn tip at the very top. Is that our halfway point? It's actually almost at the halfway point here, too. That's interesting. We don't need to adjust that barn too much distance-wise. I think this will work pretty well, actually. I mean, I can pretty much guarantee Lou this, that this is probably not going to be the only painting of his property that'll end up in the existence of the Earth. If he gives me a shot to, you know, lets me go over there again, I mean, it wouldn't necessarily be for him, and at that point it'd be, you know, something I'd want to do just for myself. Again, I really did like Westgrove as an area when I went out there many, many years ago, and I'd like to get some more I'll call them like raw shots. Yeah, like basically get more photos of it before it becomes heavily populated. I mean, it's already significantly more than it was when I would go out there, but... I'm trying to keep my hands off the mic because I've got complaints about that last time. This ain't easy. I guess this is the biggest canvas I've done, actually in a while, period, but since I started streaming, most certainly. It is a bit of a funky angle here going on at the front of the barn because you have this lower level, you know, and as I look at it, though, you know, this part tips down, but because of the way the perspective's working, it almost feeds directly. That is almost a straight line, isn't it? Yes, it is. Shite, dude, that was crazy. Well, that is almost exact. But these two, like, almost perfectly feed into each other. So I gotta... And that's throwing me off a little bit. It's like that one goes down only slightly. Should actually be tilted back farther. Just thinking about perspective again. Yeah, I was thinking about that, like I said, when we were talking of, if we were watching the drawing streams, I was working on this a little bit, like this angle, like, you know, the drawing of this barn, specifically. Yeah, we were drawing it from the other side. Trying to think of it in the three dimensionality for this piece. So nothing else is going to take the picture from like the other photo was from like over here looking at that way. Now we were over here looking at the house and down this way. But that drawing helps us think about this barn now. Because we can think about there's some, and now I could see something I couldn't really identify the first time I was looking at it. That was there pretty much just to call shit. Now it wasn't his, they don't have. Some couches, so now this is really an interesting trick because we're drawing. Anytime you're drawing trees, you gotta figure out where you're drawing through the leaves. You don't need to take the leaves are giving you hints about what branches are, but you gotta kind of, you know, split the difference and figure it all out. Because at some point, real low in this, and I'll try to hold up the good camera. Alright, somewhere around here, the tree splits. You gotta figure that out. Where exactly? Nice little clumps, so it's that happened on the painting. identify it. I was kind of restricted to where I could do it, first off. Wasn't really her dad, but she called him her dad. Oh, that ain't good. I'm gonna have to replace this mic. Anyway. It's not locking in. I think my lock broke. I'm gonna need a new cable. That's what it is, isn't it? Shit. That ain't good. Anyway. I would only be able to go in there whenever I take off from work and on weekends and stuff. So it was usually early in the semester, or the first semester, so it was like fall time, which I got some really nice colors out of it when I would take the photos. But a lot of leaves were already losing, a lot of trees were losing their leaves. So, like I said, I may have gotten trees like this, but they were already dead. But I like this one. I like that tree. It was kind of cool. Lou took us on a tour of the barn and everything. And he's like, yeah, I used to have pigeons up here. And then no sooner as you say it, I see three pigeons or whatever fly up there. I was like, oh, you still got them. And he goes, yeah, they keep getting in. I don't know how they. And as we're watching it, one of them flies straight into this window and bounces back. Like, it's just like, thunk. Fluttered away. I was cracking up. It was very funny to watch that. So you can tell that pigeons are certainly not crows. Crows are smart as shit. Pigeons are dumb as fuck. I don't know why, fuck is stupid and shit's smart, but whatever. I didn't come up with the idioms. Of course, sometimes you'd be dumb as shit. I don't know. Yeah, maybe it's something simpler, like your team lost. It's not like I'm in psychology or anything. If you also haven't noticed, I accidentally did not charge my headphones the whole week, so they're dead and I can't listen to my music, so I'm gonna prattle on and lose my thought much easier than I normally do. My bad. I was telling my wife about certain things I would like to do on this stream. Things I would like to start to make it better. Certain things. Camera. I'll be honest. I think I might be able to get a new one after this commission. We're going to have to see how some of the other financial stuff plays out. A lot of it depends on my Verizon Wireless bill, believe it or not. Because they... when my wife and I bought our phones, they were like the buy one, get one, or whatever. And... supposed to be like a credit every month because we do like the financing thing or whatever, and they have yet to put that credit on my bill, and if they don't do it soon, I mean, we're talking now almost 4 months of backlog that they owe me. So if they do it soon, my Verizon bill next month will be like, you know, $30. But, and so if I can finish this before that, you know, that's a little extra money. I can get a decent camera to put back here. And that's what I would really like. Because then I could take this fucking thing and move it the fuck back. I don't know. We'll see. It's kind of complicated because it's like sometimes I think, okay, well, I can maybe get the camera this time. And then it's like, no, I need more paints. Or I need a new canvas. I'm going to run out of canvas. I mean, I should clarify that. I'm not running out of canvas anytime soon. Like, I have... How many did we stretch? We stretched 4. So this one, 3 more. Okay. I got a canvas over there. I got a canvas over here. So we got 5 in the waiting wings right here. And that should get us through the year. I've got 4 other small sets that I haven't stretched yet, but I can fit at least 3 of them, I think. 2 or 3, but I think 3. Without any real major issues on what canvas I have left. So... You know, I got enough to keep working for a while. But once that's out, that's out. And so I'll need to see where I'm at. If I'm getting more commissions and you know, then that's great. If I've sold a few, you know, that'd be great. I mean, you know, sell prints or whatever. Oh, I didn't do all that shit. Hold on. I forgot to do this earlier. I think that's all good. And if you want to know the regular website, it's twosocietystudios.com. The number 2, society, spelled out. That's actually one of the reasons why I signed up for Society 6, because I saw them and I was like, Society? Hey, that's in my name. All right, whatever. Maybe I'll get some extra pull. Oh, fuck that, man. Whatever. But, you know, if stuff starts selling or whatever, or starts getting commissions, or starts doing something else, you know, it'll be a different ball game, you know. My kids were funny, meeting Lou's son, you know, rambunctious kid, and he's 3 years old, whatever, right? So my kid's like, he's crazy when we're coming out. Yeah, he's all over the place. And I was like, yeah, you guys were, like, probably worse. I've had to be honest. The way my kids were, especially once Sophia came, Vincent turned into a little hellion. And I got it. Oh, I just kicked it enough to. Okay, well. You gotta look at the back of my head for a little bit. Yeah, it's not quite there, but it's close enough. Can I tilt this maybe a little bit better? No, whatever. So, because as much as I want to tilt that camera back, I would also need, I guess, I think I need a capture card. I have an HDMI input, so I don't know if I do or don't. It might need to be converted. I don't know. And that's where I run into issues. The camera, at least the, what I would say would be a temporary camera, it should be a better fit, at least. It's about $200 I've been looking at. I mean, there's a really good camera I would like, which I tried for a, I tried to get a grant to help me buy, and they didn't let me do it, but, I mean, they said it was good, but it just wasn't what they wanted for the grant. Okay, that's a good thing to notice. The porch does not go all the way up to the edge there. Okay, so that means that comes in a little more then, because I had that wrong. Okay. But, like, the good camera I want is, like, $1,000, but... I figure if I get that one, I can literally like shove it like in the back of the room, pretty much, yeah. And like have the canvas face this way again, which would open up the microphone area a little better, and I could put the fucking thing way over there and up near my Star Wars figures, and be fine. And I'd have to also think about, like I said, there's all sorts of weird factors that come into play with, and when it comes to trying to figure out how I can make this stream better. Like I said, financial-wise, it keeps falling under places. Like I said, I think, I need to buy more cerulean, and that's $23 a tube. I need to buy more, you know, whatever, and that's... another $15 per tube, and so I have to think about that stuff beforehand. But I do think I can do something maybe just a little bit to make it easier on here, so there's not as much dead air time on here, and to get like a little compose something through like GarageBand or something that could then air, you know, have running in the background. It's funny. I suck at playing guitar. If you've listened to it, if you've come to this show regularly, you've seen I suck at singing. But I still do it all the time. I'm not too terrible. I'm actually at composing stuff. Like, I kind of understand what works well together. It's just I can't play it. So it's like... years and years ago, I actually was part of a band. I was every now and then I'd pull something out of my ass when they had me covering for bass. Like for a while, we didn't have a bassist, so I just had to kind of fill in. And that was right before he ended up finally just going, break it up. But the we're covering Voodoo Child, I think, one day just at practice, and I started doing something. Mike, he might be hosting me. He was on earlier, so I don't know if he's live now. He might be live. He's a Theseus Paradox on here. I think that's right. Theseus Paradox. He comes up to me like later that night. He's like, dude, I was listening to the recording we did today, and he goes, the fuck were you doing during Voodoo Child? I was like, what do you mean? It's like, at the end of the Voodoo Child, you did something, man. You changed the entire goddamn key of the song. He's like, but it was fucking amazing. He's like, nobody's ever played it like that. I was like, I don't know, it just sort of sounded right.
And I thought it would go well, because I
was like, I know that, like, you know. This is goddamn, like, let's see, Allie was, I think, three, 4 years old, so we're talking now 17 years ago. So don't ask me to remember what it was, but it was just one of these things where, and we lost the recording since then. So it's like one of those things, like I think I can figure stuff out, but I can't play it usually because I suck. So hopefully I can come up with something decent. I can. Long story short, too late, I know. Hopefully I can come up with something decent so you guys have something to listen to. Besides my prattling. Especially because there will be moments where I know I'm going to start hitting like a focus point, you know, and I'm not going to talk a lot. That's just going to happen sometime. And admittedly, the more and more that I stream and the more and more that I stream without anybody really giving feedback, like not being here and talking and, you know, interacting, I'm going to run out of shit to say. And then, you know. I don't want to do to you guys like I did to my therapist, where it was like I'd start going in and, you know, I'm bitching about work and, you know, the trouble it causes me all the time. Like, my therapist was like, okay, yeah, work sucks, let's go. Like, until you can figure out a way out of it, like, I mean, it's a problem that just exists, and you have to learn to deal with it, and it was... And I was feeling that way, too. It wasn't really, I mean, it's not like he was doing that stuff to me, I should explain that. But, like, I kind of, it's the same sensation I get when I talk to my wife. It was like, okay, yeah... Yeah, everybody deal with their assholes, and we've heard it. And that's the problem of my work. Is if I describe to you guys on a daily basis something that happens, you would think I already told you this story before, because the same things repeat, just with new orders. But usually it's the same customers, it's the same... type of product that we have issues with, and so it would literally start sounding like I'm just repeating myself all the time. Okay, so we got that kind of there. Look, I'm betting this drawing's at least going to take through, let's see, it's 8:46 tonight. We'll stream till about 10 tonight, I think. Time to go upstairs and put my kids to bed. And I'll be honest, I didn't sleep much this weekend, and I'm kind of exhausted. Yesterday, my wife went on a, what's it called, like, Taste of Brooklyn tour with my cousin runs bus trips. My wife went up with my mother and my oldest daughter, and they all went up there, or whatever. But they had to leave here. Ah, shit. Got my pencil. Hold on. Hold on to here. Wood wires. They had to leave here at like 7:30 in the morning, something like that. Or she got up that early or something. I forget. But once she was up. About 8 o'clock or so, my boy came into my room because he has to charge his Kindle in there because we don't trust him anywhere else with it. Cause he'll watch it all night and shit. And so he comes in the room, unplugs his Kindle, and goes down in the basement and turns on the PlayStation 4. So now I'm hearing, you know, gunfire in my basement. And, you know, I... 11-year-old boy screaming, God damn it! You know, like, stuff like that. If you guys were on the stream the other day with drawing, you'll see it. That was interesting. I don't know if you guys heard him or not. But, and then, you know, so, yeah, it's like I'm not in a comfortable spot now, because it's like, okay, my wife's gone, you know, no lazy Saturday, you know, type thing. And then, like I said, sound the gunfire in your basement. That tends to wake you up, even if you know it's fake. Your body just sort of goes, hey, we're getting shot at. And you're like, no, we're not. And hey. And so you're just up. And so I was up much earlier than I wanted to be on a Saturday. And then today, we had the Phillies game from yesterday got called off because of rain. So today's game was moved up to 12:05 from 1:35. So we were leaving earlier for that, and my wife likes to make sure, again, we're all up early and getting shit done beforehand. So, again, it was like a probably, 8:30 type day or whatever. And it's Saturdays and Sundays, man. I like to sleep in. I like to sleep. I'm sorry. That's one habit I never got out of from, high school, basically. Time off, man. Do not try to get me up before 10:30. At least give me till 10:30. I like to sleep. Now, on the contrast of that, I should say that I also, if given the opportunity, will stay up late all the time too. So it's like one of those, if you were to start me like, let's say I'm able to somehow start making a living off of this shit from painting, right? I don't give a shit about the streaming, but say I'm able to make it from the painting, one way or the other. All right, so no more regular job for me. Yay, right? That'd be great. Fucking A. Unfortunately, I will tell you almost immediately, my regular schedule will drop down to something where it's like I'll wake up at 11 and go to bed at probably 2 in the morning. Yeah, something like that. And that's when I'll be streaming till 2 then at those points. Just because I immediately go night owl the second I don't have to work or do anything. Oh, this is such a pain in the balls. I've got to figure out a better mic setup. I won't lie, I've been looking into Bluetooth mics just to see if there was something I could pull off, hook it up through this and just go with it, a little battery pack or whatever, a TV anchor type bullshit. I was looking into those even. Those still seem a little bit pricey for me. I'd like to pull that off, I'll have to sell all my good paintings. They are for sale at twosocietystudios.com. Just FYI, if anybody's out there. Nice painting. Even though I know shipping is going to be well over $150, I said only $50 to ship. So if you want to buy it, you're going to get shipped to you for cheaper than what it actually would cost me to ship it. Is that enough muttering and guilt tripping? No? I can do more. So you have to remember that, as I said, my daughter, my oldest, is now 21, turning 22 in November. And see, with her, I was really quite able to just raise her with the whole, I'm disappointed kind of, thing. As opposed to, these two younger ones, I swear to God, they're just immune to anything. Can't guilt trip them. You can't, They'll just make it worse no matter whatever you try. We were talking about that tonight at dinner with my mother. We were out for Chinese. And the kids started acting up a little bit. And my mom goes, I used to get coffee with when your father was little. And we would sit here and drink our coffee. And the more that you're... father and your uncle would act up, the more we would slow down drinking our coffee. And my wife and I were talking about how that won't work for us because we pretty much, my brother, my sister and I, we bickered a little. As most siblings do. But my two brats, man, holy shit. They make my brother, my sister and I look like fucking amateurs, man. We look like we had no idea how to actually have a sibling rivalry, So my two will turn the restaurant into a fucking war zone if we tried to pull that shit. I mean, my wife and I said that sometimes we're the ones pushing to get the hell out of the restaurant because they're embarrassing the shit out of us, and they're turning it, everyone is looking at us because Sophia's because Vincent, you know, finished the bread, his breadstick first. And I wish I was fucking joking that hasn't, you know, that hadn't happened to us before. That has happened. And now this would be almost understandable were I to say that they are, you know, I keep forgetting. I got to look at the mic because this mic keeps fading out. You know, were they 4-year-olds, 5-year-olds, you know, in that range still, I would say that's understandable. My son's 11, my daughter's 8, and they still, many ways, will behave as if they are, you know, toddlers if they want to start really getting under our skins. So, like I said, as much as I want to be a hard-ass parent sometimes, like my parents were, outside of flat-out, you know, turning into an abuser, which I would not do, like, sometimes it's just like, dude, I can't win against them. The only thing we can do is hope to get them home and away from each other, and hopefully that'll work. Because I swear to Christ, they know how to push every button imaginable on me, especially, to get me into, like, a, you know, like, raging idiot mode. Like I mentioned on the stream before here, but I'll say this story again. When we were down in Williamsburg just recently, we're coming back from Busch Gardens one night. Now, mind you, what we had gone there to do was we went to re-ride the Battle of Ire virtual reality ride, because the first time we rode it, mine wasn't working right, and I didn't see it properly. And we knew we were going to go back to the theme park anyway. And one of the things we wanted to do was ride the roller coaster Verboten, right? Something my daughter was tall enough to ride on. So we were like, okay, cool. She's tall enough. Vincent's tall enough because he's older. You know, makes sense. So we're going to ride Verboten. We're going to ride the Battle of Ire. Sophia wanted to get a henna tattoo, right? And we couldn't do it the night, the last time we had been there, because it was raining, and so they said it's not going to last if we put it on during the rain. So I said, okay, fine. We decided we'd come back a few days later. So we did, and the kids chickened out of Verboten, like, right as we were getting into the line. Like, Vincent started saying how he doesn't feel good because of this, that, and the other thing. Now, truth be told, I think he was just terrified of the goddamn roller coaster, which is really odd because, like I said, my wife and I are both coaster nuts, so we don't know where the kids get this, you know, timidness for them. So then, okay, we stuck around to watch the, it's not a fireworks show. It's like almost like a weird little rave that they have called Spark. If you've never seen it, unless you are a club goer, you may not enjoy this fully. I sure as shit didn't. It reminded me of a night we went to Shampoo, and we only went once, and there's a reason for that. But, so, I was like, okay. I was aggravated, because I was like, dude, I really wanted to ride that coaster at least. I wanted to ride, you know, one more coaster, because we only rode, what, two? Total. One was Loch Ness Monster, one was, Invader. I was like, I'd really like to finish them off, you know, like do at least one more. But we didn't get to do that, and I'm like, okay, whatever, fine. And I was bummed, but, you know, whatever. We were getting over it kind of scenario. And like I said, we sit through this terrible goddamn, like, techno thing, light show. I'm like, okay, alright, we're leaving. Alright. So we leave.
I know it sounds like a long thing. Oh,
and we ate there too. So, you know, hamburgers and chicken fingers for the four of us was $70 fucking dollars.
All right. So, okay.
We cut out. On our way home, my wife's looking at her Facebook page or whatever, and she starts laughing about, you know, oh my God, that's funny. And so she shows this cartoon. She describes it to me as it's two cats, and the cat's like shoving a coffee pot or whatever, and it says, Jesus, Alfred, or whatever the hell the other cat's name is. You know, only push the cup off. You're a lovable miscreant, not a monster. Right? And I chuckle at it, and my son goes, what? And so my wife explains it again to him. And now Sophia, being the competitive Sophia that she is, because my wife did not directly explain it to her, wants my wife to tell her what the comic says. My wife says, I'm not doing it. Look. Just look. Here's my phone. And she gives her the phone so she can look at it herself. And Sophia looks at it, and she reads it, and she laughs at it, hands it back to my wife, and says, now describe it to me. Right? So, my wife says, no, you just read it, you just saw it. Yes, but you described it to Vincent, so describe it to me. And my wife says, yes, but you saw it, and Vince did not. I am not doing this. Be quiet, you know. And so Sophia starts screaming in the back. Like that, right? You know. So, my brain, again, especially ever since the crackdown, but the way my depression worked always is it likes to repeat old screw-ups, bad feelings, whatever they may be. Okay. So, whereas I was already a little disappointed in the night because, you know, well, I didn't get to ride a roller coaster because the kids backed out of it, right? Specifically, Sophia started screaming too at one point. Where I had been moving past that, you know, when I was like, okay, you know what, we had a pretty good night, whatever. Everything was fine. Because she starts the screaming in the back, my brain went, tsh. We went and got a fucking $20 henna tattoo and had to spend $70 for food to sit through a fucking terrible goddamn techno run thing. Right, you know, and the brain just starts going through all these old scenarios of shit that we just did that was not stuff I wanted to do. Instead of going to the goddamn coaster, and if we weren't going to do the goddamn coaster, we could have gone fucking, you know, at a mall and gotten a henna tattoo for $20, and then I wouldn't have had to pay $70 to eat fucking hamburgers. You know, the night before, we spent $80 at a goddamn nice Italian restaurant, got real fucking food, instead of fucking hamburgers. Right, this is all going in the head, right, before I start, you know, shut up! My wife's just, ignore her, and it's like, I can't. It's gone. The trigger has gone. It's off the rails now. It's no longer my party, you know, so to speak. Like, we are now in, you know, even though it sounds like it's a burst of anger, it is, we're in depression mode. Like, it is on now. It is on like Donkey Kong. And it's running the game now, you know. And it starts off with bursts of anger outwards, and then it'll go turn itself in on itself eventually. And so I had to try to like get my wife to grasp that concept. That's like, no, I'm not in this game anymore. Like, it's like trying to explain to people, like, oh, look at that! That actually matches up with the halfway point. Ooh, that's good. You know, like if you do suffer from depression and when the sadness type end hits, people. Oh, don't be so sad. You got so good stuff to go on, you know, blah, blah. And it's like, did you not understand you know, this doesn't work that way. Like, you know, it's not just being sad, you know, like, it's 1,000 things beyond that. Okay, that's a really thick gutter. Okay, this is going to be... This might be one of the spots where I'm going to have to do a little blurring because I think I'm not sure where I got off at. Because it doesn't seem like I'm getting the right distance here. And we might just have to let it go. One of the nice things about being a painter like I am, the style that I do, So I don't always have to hold 100% to the reality of the situation. But I do need sharper pencils. That one's okay, but I'm gonna... Hold on, you'll hear me. I'll try to yell at you. That's gambling. Alright. Okay. Okay.
Like, I had to try to explain to my dentist at one point. He was asking how I was doing at some point, blah, 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 and about my job, and I was like, yeah, at the time I was actually on a medical leave. We were doing the dentist appointment. And I was explaining to him why, and, you know, like, because I was suicidal because of my job. And he's like, what? And he's like, no. He's like, I love my dentist. Like, he's like the nicest guy ever. He's a great dentist. And he's just like, no, you have such a beautiful family. You have all the, trying to, you know, as if I was at that point suicidal. I was like, dude, I was like, Doc Strog. I'm like, I'm cool, dude, now. I'm like, it's just that, you know. I was like, and you have to, I had to explain. I'm like, dude, it's that. I know that here most of the time. But when, you know, the ugly side rears its head, you know, it takes all that stuff and turns it against itself. So it's like, I know I have a beautiful family. And then the depression says, but you've disappointed them by working this garbage job, you know? Like, it's all that weird shit that comes into play. That's, like, the stuff that I had to kind of, like, get through to him a little bit. I almost wanted to explain it to my boss when he was talking to me one time regarding certain elements of how I am at work. I'll leave it at that. And I was like, but in my head I went, you know what, fuck him. He had all the fucking warning signs of shit that was going wrong and how bad it was getting off the rails, and he's talking to me, like, I don't know, maybe you're just burnt out or something. I was like, I passed burnt out and flipped it off doing 70, you know, like, as I went by. Like, see, the kick in the balls here, the real kick in the balls, is when I talk about this stuff, the hardest part for me to pull on my own is I had this shit under control. Okay. Without medications, without any of that stuff, I had this shit worked out a long time ago. I mean, look, mentioned on here again, before, but again, I never, who's new, who's viewing, first time, whatever, right? As I said, my daughter, my oldest daughter, is almost 21 years old. She is not a child of my wife, right? She's my ex-wife, all right? I was young and dumb and you know, thought I was in love, and then we end up having a kid when I was 18, she was 19, you know. And Allie's one of the greatest things in my life, my daughter. But the hard part of it all is that to get her, I had to become a 20-year-old divorcee, all right? Because that was it, man. My ex and I were split by 20 years old, all right? So, like,
as I said in one of the previous ones, like, imagine being a 20-year-old divorcee guy. And you have, and I'm going to specify guy, because that is a change in perception on how people think. So I'm a 20-year-old divorcee with a kid, right? If you're just hearing those words, that's all you know about me. Who's the asshole? I'll adjust this a little bit. Okay? In other words, when you think about how that relationship ended, who's the asshole? Just on, you know, gut instinct. You're going to say the guy cheated on the girl or whatever, blah, 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 blah. That's and I'm fine with understanding that, you know, that on somebody's base level, if you hear those words and you say, oh, shit, well, the guy was probably to blame. And, you know, somebody now may in their head go, oh, no, I wouldn't say that. But you have to understand, even before all this, before we split, I was taking child psychology classes, and one of the books that I did a special report on was called The Youngest Parents. All right, and it was talking about teenage pregnancy and stuff, and again, in the 90s. And, like, the book's literally littered with, like, people talking about, like, well, you know, like, on the male side of it, like, I got her pregnant, she left me, and now everyone thinks I did it. You know, that I was the asshole. Like, it's not in those words exactly, but, and so it's a natural, I guess, thing to think that the guy ran off on, you know, and he's probably not even part of the kid's life. And meanwhile, I was like crazy in the amount in my kid's life. I mean, eventually, I had primary custody of her. Okay. Eventually, it took a while, but. So, I mean, I understand a lot of the stuff I ran into at college. Doesn't mean that in college it made it any easier. And I was depressed a lot through school, especially once, like, the split happened. At first, Allie went to live with her mother, so I didn't have Allie around anymore either all the time. And meanwhile, ex is dating people. She's getting, like, no issue whatsoever getting someone to, you know, hook up with or whatever, just to get any attention, whatever. It was easy and peasy for her. But me, if I had a, you know, started crushing on a girl, it was like, yeah, they're gonna hear kid and run for the fucking hills. They're gonna hear ex-wife and they're gonna run for the fucking hills. Right? Like, and there were times where I did say something. Yeah, no, too much baggage. It's like, fuck, you know. And like I said, I get it. But at the same point, I was really, really lonely and depressed for a while. But I got it under control through a study of philosophy that I was going through back then. You know, my teacher was really, really good. And he, truth be told, I was studying and already getting into some of this stuff before the split occurred. I kind of blame the split in a way, because there was parts where it was like, I wasn't putting up with any more of her bullshit when she would try to, like, she wanted to, like, hook up with my guitarist and then expect us to get back together. And I was like, no, you're not doing that. Either leave me or you're, you know. And she eventually chose to leave me. So, but that's a, like, whole other tale. Anyways, so the thing is, but the point is that I got what I was dealing with under control. Thanks to, like I said, my study of philosophy that I was doing on, and I figured it out. And I had that shit under control. Like I said before, you know, I didn't necessarily deal with mental illness so much as, like, mental inconvenience. Like, if I got depressed afterwards, it was, like, usually, like, a thing that goes, like, okay, well, you know, all right, we're down, but look, on an existential side, we're literally all that's exists in the universe. It's the only thing we can prove. So we cut this. We literally destroy everyone we love and know at one moment. You know? And it kind of like, you know, and it wasn't just that, but there was other elements in play. And believe me, if I could actually list them, I'd probably still have it under control. But the thing is, the way this job has affected me, it started chipping away at all that. and it took a little bit and a little bit and a little bit. And that's impressive. I'll give that to them. Because you also have to keep in mind, I said, now, okay, I was able to get through the whole being a single father, you know, with nobody having any interest in me or whatever. Cool. All right. Well, I get out of the school, and not long after, I actually met my wife, and she stood right up to it and was like, okay, you're dad with an ex-wife. Cool. Whatever. I like you. And I was like, cool. This chick's got some balls. And literally, like, the next night, like, after our second date, my ex-wife ended up coming into where we were, and that was fun. But, holy shit, that was the most awkward. Anyway. And she just sort of, like, brushed it off, like, okay, well, she's a petty bitch. Got it. Okay, we're going to deal with this. And she was fine. And like I said, she dealt with it. But my ex eventually, once my wife and I got engaged, decided to start some shit, and we had to go through a custody battle. Eventually, I won, but it was a drawn-out process. It was almost 5 years, I think, by the time it was finally said and all done. Let's see. Yeah, oh no, maybe about four. It was about 4 years because we were out in Malvern. But, you know, but it got me through that. It got me through all that stuff because it was a back and forth thing for a while. It really was not. I was wondering if we were going to end up in the point where my ex-wife was doing like she did when she first had custody of Allie when she first left, which was like using her almost like a weapon on me. Like, okay, well, you can't see your kid anymore if you don't do this, you know, and that shit. And I was like, you know, I literally told my wife, I said, if we lose, I'm like, you have full permission to bolt. I said, I will almost insist upon it that you just cut out. I'm like, because you're not going to want to live under her thumb, and she's going to try to put me under her thumb. And everything's going to get ugly. You know, it got me through all that. Like I said, all the stuff I had in place. And then I get to this shithole job, and they chipped away at me, and chipped away at me, and chipped away at me. And then, you know, I lost all that. I don't have any of it anymore. So now I'm on medications and shit just to try to keep me from really losing my shit. But they're not high enough to completely quell it, you know. They're more of the, because my doctors and I all got to a point where we did agree that we don't want to wipe it out. If that makes any sense. And I know that sounds like really weird that your psychiatrist would be like, yeah, I don't want you to actually lose all your depression through the medication. We're going to keep you at like just a little bit of a depression. But that was more on some of the insistence that I had regarding that. Look, I can't be sedated. You know what I mean? Like, I cannot be like people that you see sometimes on medications for depression and stuff that are just zoned out. Like, I can't be this dude. Right? Because if I'm that dude, I'm not this dude. That makes sense. All right? You know. The shit that feeds this has its basis there. It has a, you know, its birthplace, unfortunately, in that nasty ass area. It's a really weird roof. I don't think I'm hitting this yet. I think I'm kind of off. The wire here is fucking with me. It's cutting in a weird spot, and it's like, goes back, but it doesn't. Like, if that's a halfway point, roughly, this should be back here. I guess that's right. Okay, we'll do it that way. That angle looks better. This is. Let's get a new eraser. This is beat the shit. Like I said, that's probably 10 years old, easy.
guess this is like the one plus for you guys if you're sort of bored and entertained. Yeah, and want to be entertained. Like,
I'll literally tell you my whole fucking life story up here if I don't get anybody talking back to me.
It's pretty fucked up
in a lot of places, but I like to refer to it as like almost tragic.
If that makes any sense, like there were a lot of times where I was like
almost tragic situations. And like, look, yeah, sure. I can talk about, like, if I talk about my ex-wife, it's like,
okay, yeah, shit,
it sucked. All right? I mean, that did suck being a, fungal.
Excuse me, drop my eraser.
Like, look, that sucked being 20 years old. And not being able to, like, you know. Like, look, I went to art school. First off, so, and I was a commuter, so there were no frats or any of that bullshit. There weren't dorm parties or anything else for me to go to, so it's not like I could pull off the normal college lifestyle of, like, random hookups that you never see again type idea, right? I want to make sure I mark this area just a little bit. So that was, you know, not an option for me technically. Plus, because I was a young father and had other shit to deal with, I was working nearly full time, about 35 hours or so, if not more sometimes, a week while going to school full time. So, you know, that's another big, you know, kicking the balls for trying to get into any type of anybody's attention. So there was a lot of, like, all those little weird moments, which sucked. But in the long run, you know, I got my wife out of it. So that's pretty good. You know? Siemens, most certainly, as a place of employment, has been terrible for me. It's been a bad match as a job for me. It's caused a great deal of anguish and pain. Okay? That's true. And that's all, you know, something that I'm trying to fix. I'm trying to get out of there. I actively apply regularly and have shit up on Indeed and all that stuff. But can't right now. Okay? Okay, that sucks. But had I not had the breakdown, and this is one of those, like, I had the breakdown probably because I wasn't painting to fight it off. But I had stopped painting for a while, and, yeah, after my friend's death, because I associated it with it, so I stopped painting, which then led to the stress and shit bothering me, you know, but in the end, that breakdown got me back into it. It got me back to working because I was literally prescribed it by my doctor. He literally had it told me, you need to paint again. And I was honestly, now, like I said, I say, hey, that's Dr. Miran, who was my psychologist, my psychiatrist, Dr. Sackett. She was going off of a lot of notes that Dr. Miran had. Off of what I would tell her, you know, when I went to her office 2 weeks after my breakdown. And she sat there and she was going through, you know, the stuff, and she looked at me and she just basically said, like, look, you know, she goes, there's a chance under normal circumstances that I might even suggest hospitalization in this. And I was like, oh, good God. I'm like, I'm like inches from getting sent to a psych ward. Holy shit. Like, oh my God. Right. But she goes, I think for you that's wrong. And she goes, you know, what I'm hearing here is I'd already done a few museum visits, and I talked about how, you know, just kind of reconnecting to certain points there was having a bit of an effect on me. Yeah, you know, it was helping feel a little more normal. And so she goes, like, look, she goes, if you think you want to go to a hospital, she goes, I'll send you. She goes, but I don't think that's right for you. She goes, and I said, well, I'd prefer not to. And, you know, I was like, that's, she goes, okay, well, good. She goes, I don't think that's the right solution for you. She's like, we got to get you painting again. And it's very funny because actually, like, I guess what now? That's over a year, but it was about, I guess, 3 or 4 months ago. She actually asked if she could see one of my paintings. She said she'd never seen it. Yeah, she didn't know, and she was. I think she thought I was just like a dude who painted on the side, like, you know, would go to dude like, what are those things called? Painting with a twist or whatever. All right. I think that's what she thought I was doing or something. I don't know. Or like Bob Ross painting or something, you know? Like, and, because she saw it, she saw my, I showed her my view of tulips because it was the easiest one for me to get to quickly. That was finished because I was working on something at the time. And she was just, she saw it and went, oh, wow. she stopped like in the middle of the thing. Oh, wow, look at that. She's like, I wasn't expecting this. She literally looked at me like that. I was like, yeah, okay. It's like, all right, well, I don't know how I could come in here and tell you guys like how fucking important it is for me to paint. And then you guys are like, oh, shit, you know what you're doing. You can paint pretty well.
It was funny. I actually chuckled that one. But, yeah, they all, like,
prescribed it to me, basically. Like, they, like Dr. Mirren and literally was telling me when I finally went on medical leave for it, he goes, okay, you need to go to a museum.
That was like the first thing. He goes, before anything else, he goes, you need to go and
go look at people that you like. And try to touch yourself, like that part of yourself again. About to say try to touch yourself again. You gotta try to jack it. No, anyway. No, you know, he's like, you gotta get back with that mindset. And, so that's what I did right after, like I said, right afterwards. I went to the Barnes Foundation for the first time. And it's funny, I bought the journal I'm still kind of working on in right now. But if you read, like, the first group of notes in there, it's all notes from the Barnes. And it's terrible. Like, they're really bad. They're just literally like, okay, this is, all right, this is a Van Gogh. You know, I'm guessing from Arles, this is, you know, blah, blah. All right, this Surratt's kind of cool. You know, I guess like it's like really like, all right, this is crap. I don't like this one. Yeah, whatever it may be. Like, you know, like it's really shallow in how it was written by me. And like half the time it was like if I liked something, I would literally just write study ? Like as if to do a study of it. And you know, no deeper thoughts than that, really, it seemed. And it took till I got to, like, the very end of that day to start writing some decent notes. And even those, I think, are pretty bad compared to, like, I went back on my birthday that year. And the notes I wrote were just much more detailed, much more, you know, fleshed out as far as an actual thought process went. And I even wrote in there, I was like, Jesus Christ, what a difference a year makes. Because I were garbage in here before. It's like, when I left on my birthday, when I was leaving the Barnes, somebody actually, seen me writing. And they looked at me as I was going to, I think, the locker that I put my backpack in or whatever. Yeah. And they were getting their backpacks or whatever and their bags and shit and leaving. And they looked at me and go, I want a copy of your notes because whatever the hell you were writing. She's like, you were writing a ton. I was like, yeah, you don't want them. I just looked at her like, you don't want these notes because they're more in depth, they're more thought out, but they ain't any happier. Let's put that one. I mean, there was stuff that was just like, okay, well, you know.
A lot of times there'd be comments about, like, how I felt maybe some of my art teachers had failed me in college because they didn't introduce me to some of these artists and stuff that were in there that I hadn't seen before or whatever. Or perhaps they had something different somewhere else that I just passed over because it didn't have the same flair that those things did or whatever.
Or it might have been talking about something that was related to how I was feeling about, you know, something at work or whatever, all that stuff. Or how I was feeling about something, you know, that I was working on. And so it was kind of, like I said, I'm like looking at this lady like, no, you don't want this at all. Like, not even slightly. Mailbox, okay. Check the mailbox out. Because the mailbox is connected to the front steps, connected to the hip bone. No, not at all. So the house doesn't have a hip bone. What are you people, crazy? I got nothing but stalker viewers. Somebody talk. What do we got? What is that name? Banana Nanan?
I like that name.
Who's that? Come on. You there? Who's there? See, it tells me there's only two viewers, but then it lists five names here. I don't get it. Fix your shit, Twitch. I gotta know how many people are actually watching. So I know how I'm talking to. I'd like to get another viewer at some point, man. That'd be cool. Or another, not viewer, another follower. We're up to, what, 26 now, I think? I don't think... Are you a follower, Banana Nan? Banana Nan Nan. Banana Nan. No? Nobody's coming with me on that one? All right. Well, fuck yourselves. No. Should I be really abrasive? Would that be work? I don't know. See, my whole view of what is good, quotes, on this type of stuff, you know, like live streaming or, you know, I mean, usually it's out of gaming situations, I guess. I don't watch a whole lot of, like, Let's Players or whatever, I guess is what they refer to them as, or anything like that. I watch John Sandman, and I watch Game Grumps, and that's about it. Sometimes I'll watch Woofles or Phantom Ace. Sometimes I watch Sunless Con. Just, again, mostly Rocket League tips, because I suck at Rocket League still, and I hate that I suck at Rocket League still, as long as I've been playing the damn game. Though I haven't played in weeks now at this point. But I digress. I've been playing the shit out of House Flipper for whatever reason. But what my son watches a lot seems to be, like, super abrasive to the people watching. Like, you know. Some, at least half of them that he watches are, like, you know. I don't know. Oh, you fucking... I don't know. And maybe it's just to the players. I don't know. It's like I'm not watching. I hear a lot more of it than... And usually, the second it starts getting really profane, he mutes it real quick and runs into another room. Because he thinks somehow that I don't know what's happening. I will say this. It must have some terrible effect on him because he was playing Call of Duty yesterday. I think it might have been Call of Duty Black Ops with his buddies. And I'll be honest, listening to him talk to his friends, I don't know how they're friends with him. And this is coming from his father. I seriously would have dropped his ass probably by, you know, the end of that game. And I'm trying to, I told him that, and I was like, dude, this is just like as a, you know, like a fair warning to you about life, dude. You can't talk to people like that, even if you think you, you know, they like you. At some point, you keep yelling at people about, why the hell are you a sniper? They're going to say, you know what? Go F yourself. And not in a humorous way, you know? Like, you know, I'm being facetious because there's nobody on here talking, so I can tell you go fuck yourselves because nobody's here. Somebody starts talking, my tone will change immediately. Just saying. If you said something right now. Like right now. Damn it. Nothing. Now what if you guys are actually trying to talk, but you're trying to use like all sorts of like weird like racist shit, and that's all blocked out, so... But then again, you guys would be viewers, and I wouldn't want, because I wouldn't want any of that shit. Hate that shit. I won't call out who, but one of my son's friends, they were doing a chat on not Facebook, on PlayStation Network, and I get all the messages, too, on my phone. And I saw someone, and I was like, yo! No, thank you! And I had to, like, literally, like, tear down the steps to my son, and was just like, listen... I see one of these come out of, you know, your name, which is actually my name on there. And I was like, or I see, hear it come out of your mouth. I was like, I will rip you up so fast. I'm like, you have no idea how quickly, you know, you will lose, like, everything. Because he did that once. And I mean once. And I'm mortified by it. That he dropped a word. And I don't even think I tell you what word it is or what letter it starts with, and you can understand how quickly that I got pissed. You know, like, let's put it this way. You know, I have far too many friends that are of, I don't like using the term minority. I hate that, but if you want to call it that, like, of any. Across the boards. You know, pick a group. I got too many of them to let you use any racial slur against them. I mean, literally, pick one. Anyone. Except blind albino circus midgets. I don't like that. Blind albino pygmy circus midgets. I should be specific. That's a stupid story. And I will share it, too. But, like, no. Like, so I... like, there's... There's not a bit of me that tolerates racism. There's not a bit of me that tolerates sexism. There's not a bit of me that tolerates any type of homophobe nature, any of it. Right? And so he dropped a word that, like I said, is a bad one. It's a bad one. And I ripped around the corner. I was in the bathroom at the time. And I'll be honest, I would not have been surprised if there had been a trail of piss following me, because I ripped around the corner so fast, and I don't even know if I had finished. Like, I mean, I swear to God, I just jumped in that room, and I was like, yo! And he, laying on his bed, jumped like 3 feet in the air. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't think he would ever heard me scream like that at him, and I just went off, and I was like, this is the bullshit that you get from your goddamn YouTube videos. I was like, I'll tear the shit out of those break every goddamn one of your machines right now. I'll tell the school, because he has an iPad through school. I'm like, I'll tell the school I goddamn ripped it apart. Like, you know, I'll go full Hulk on the goddamn thing. Just snap it. Like, I had no problem with that if I wanted to. I mean, I probably couldn't do it that easily, but I'll take a sledgehammer to it. Damn sure, if I thought that was the problem. Yeah, because he doesn't get it from my house. That's for damn sure. I had the feeling he got it from the friend that called it. Yeah, I called out on it later. And I was like, yeah, no, that doesn't fly here. I was like, we'll go on a little tour I'll literally call all my friends like I said, all my black friends, I'll call all my gay friends, I'll call, you know, my trans friends, all of them. We're going to go meet every one of them, buddy, and you're going to get to know them all to make sure that you understand that when you drop one of these bad, you know, these profane, you know, garbage names and words, like, it's like you're describing someone I care about. I was like, you know, I think he got it. I think he eventually started to get it because I actually would introduce him to people sometimes. You know, obviously, you know, African-American friends, he's going to pick up that they're African-American. Not hard to hide. But, like, especially for, like, semi-gay friends. Like, we went up to visit a friend of mine up in Lake Erie, and he, you know, just knew it was my daddy's friend Phil. Like, that's all I am, you know? So, like, later on, after we were, like, on our way home, you know, I was telling about, like, the time that Phil finally introduced me to his boyfriend that at the time. Now, they're not together anymore, but, you know, and how I had been upset that he had not told me he was gay before that. Now, I had known because somebody else told me. But as I said, it bothered me that he didn't tell me, that he didn't feel comfortable enough, and, you know. And so it was like, he pulled back, like, wait, Phil's gay? And I was like, yeah, he's a gay man. And he was like, oh. I'm like, yeah. Like, it was like, you know, like, holy shit, he's a normal person. I'm like, yeah, they're normal people. Isn't that funny? I'm like, dude, you know. It helps too, like my niece is a lesbian and she came, yeah, she's been very open and out with it. And so it helps a little bit there too, because it was like, okay, like, you know, say we're watching the CW or something like that with, like, Flash or Supergirl or anything like that, you know. Every now and then, like, Sophia be like, wait, is that girl kissing that girl? And we're like, yeah, because they're gay. And she's like, and they'll kind of look at it for a second, like, Sophia especially when she's younger. She's getting a little more now, but she'd look at it and go, like Sammy? And, yes, like Sammy. Ah, okay. And that's it. That's where it sort of stops with it, you know. They get it. So I think I've done okay with him on this part now. Jesus, I was angry that day, though. Oh, my God. Whew. And that wasn't the depression running or anything else. That was just flat-out rage. He's lucky he didn't end up with a foot in his ass on that one. Oh, God damn. I still get a little tweaky on it. It's like, Jesus Christ.
I mean,
I think I told him, I said, if it were up to me, the word would be completely abolished out of the English language. I said, with the exception of, you know, rappers being allowed to use it if they wish to. Like I said, because that's like kind of the ownership of, you know, the whole premise behind that was taking ownership of that word again. You know, and I was like, dude, and that's it. And I was like, and said, listen to me, you know, when I sing along to a lot of these rap songs, I pretty much almost always catch myself and edit, like, and don't say it, you know, because it's not my word. You know what I mean? Like, it's the rapper's song, it's their stuff. I don't want to do it. We used to, my band, we used to cover, Woo-ha from Busta Rhymes. And now I did drop the ending with an A version of this word that I just like so much. Literally after talking to everybody I could that I could reach easily. This is before, you know, easy internet days of Facebook or whatever. But literally, like, I went to my buddy Jason. I'm like, Jay, should I say this or should I edit it? Because if I edit it to turn it to cracker or something like that, I'm like, that feels disingenuous. It feels like we're not covering the song. Like, you know, I'm switching it or whatever. And I'm like, and that feels wrong. But to say it feels wrong, I'm like, what do I do? I was like, what, you know, Not that Jason can speak for all black people, but, you know, hey, like, you're one of my best friends. What? How do you think I should handle this? You know, as a musician, as an artist, you know, that wants to do right by the song, I also am wildly uncomfortable because I don't like that word at all. And he was like, nah, he's like, it's fine, dude. He's like, you're doing the song. He's like, you know, he's like, anybody gives you trouble, I'll stand up. And I asked a couple other friends, and they were like, yeah. By the time it was done, they're like, you do it. And I was like, all right. I'm like, I'll do it. Not that we ever played it anywhere, so it doesn't matter. But I was like, dude, okay. And then after that, I'll be honest, I sing in the car, and I still don't sing the word. That's still, you know what? No. That's Busta's word, not mine. At this point, I'm sorry. Just not. I can't do it. The downside of taking this photo on a day when the weather was absolute garbage is that there's certain points I'm looking at, like, is that window, like, got two of the little, like, yeah, we're going to have to start focusing instead of trying to get these leaves right, because I'm running into a bunch of issues regarding these leaves. This should be up here. Yeah, that should be up there. Okay. And we're just going to have to start, like, focusing on the physical elements that we can see and then just kind of plow our way through what the leaves are shot, you know, in between the leaves. Because, like, right here, I'm going to see that this, you know, as I talk about that barn, again, that three-dimensionality that we were doing in the drawing, that should be that, you know what I mean? Now, again, I know that the barn's there. I know there's certain spots here that are going to be like that. We're cool in there. We're cool on the leaves there. All right, don't need to worry too much about that. There is a little car back here. If you guys can't tell from the picture, and it's not too easy to see there. There's a few. You can see the few cars in the corner down there, you know. I guess it's left of the on the screen here. Yeah, left-hand corner. But he's actually got a bunch of cars, you know, all in various conditions, you know, because Lou's a big car guy. He likes to fix cars up, so. Some taken completely apart and, you know, like all sorts of stuff. It's pretty cool. I wish I understood that stuff. That's just not me. I remember years ago I had a pretty much a piece of shit Toyota Corolla. And I had wanted to soup it up. Like, even though it was an automatic, I wanted it to, like, at least have some extra horsepower. Then the, did my wife and I? Oh, my wife and I had our first few dates with that, too, yeah. So I was in that car. So I met this chick suddenly, and then I got to spend money on dates and shit. So that sort of killed that momentum on that. But, and then additionally, I was driving, actually, my buddy Jason, I was just talking about. I'd taken him back to his house, which at the time was up in Plymouth Meeting. And I'm coming back down the Blue Route at, like, you know, 1:30 in the morning or something. That's stupid. Might not have been that late, but it was pretty late. And my car just goes, right? And, like, I'm like, what the fuck? And I pull it over, right? And I turn it off, and I try to turn it on again. And I start going again, and the car's, all right, and that sucker ain't getting above 50. It's as high as it will go. I am gunning it. I am foot on the gas all the way down, and I am getting out of the engine, right? Like nothing. And like I said, it just kept jerking on me. It kept going crazy on me. And I'm like, what the fuck is this? So I pull over, I call, you know, AAA or whatever, and then they come, I call my dad. I'm like, hey, yeah, I'm on the Blue Route. My car has just shit the bed. I'm going to get it taken over to... God, who was our mechanic at the time? I can't remember the mechanic's name. Yeah, I was like, I'm going to need you to pick me up from there. Because, yeah. And so, that was a fun call. Like, it would have been one thing, you know. As bad as it sounds, I think, it's one thing if you're... Because I was about, I guess I was, well, let's see, probably about 21, 22, maybe 22. And it's not like I'm calling my folks like, hey, I'm drunk and I can't come home, or, you know, or something like that, or, you know, I need a ride. It's like, nah, it's 2 in the morning. I was just drinking coffee with Jason, and I was taking him home, and now I'm stuck on the Blue Route. Like, hey, fun stuff. You know, like, it's, I think my dad would almost prefer to have heard, like, you know, hey, I got arrested for drunk driving or something. Can you come get me? And then he'd be like, you can stay in prison until morning. Because that's what my dad would have done. FYI to my kids, if they get to see this before, you know, they're all grown up or whatever, that's what I'll do to you. You can sit in a holding cell for a night. Because that shit will get you to think the fuck you did. There are times I literally cannot tell if I'm a good father or a terrible father. My daughter wrote a sweet article about me one time. For, I forget the website now. Odyssey? Something like that? She did a brief job writing for him. And she did a Father's Day one for me. And just saying, like, jobs that fathers have that you don't think about or something like that. And it was it's a neat little breakdown. Yeah. Won't lie. Ride like an infant when I read it. Now again, here we're talking about a little bit of perspective. You got these two, you know. They must be legit chimneys, because they do have fireplaces in there, so they must be legit chimneys, not just exhausts for heat. But, you know, you got to figure out exactly how this is playing into that, to this. And there's something a little off, because I'm not hitting this. And it might be because that should be a little wider, a little sooner down here. And this might actually need to go like that. That feels a little better, actually. Yeah, it feels a little better. Speaking of feeling a little better, dude, I gotta say, if you have not seen the Shazam trailer yet, watch that shit. Damn, that movie looks good. Like, they captured that essence of what Billy Batson should behave like. You know what I mean? Because sometimes that bothered me, that when Shazam turned to Shazam, I mean, he turned to Captain Marvel. I'm old school. I do remember that. But anyway, you know, now he's Shazam. But anyway, when he would turn, suddenly he was like a grown-up. And that bugged the shit out of me for a long time. You know? There were a lot of comics where suddenly he's behaved, you know, he became Captain Marvel, and now he's a man, and so he behaves like a man. And it's like, dude, he's still a little boy. Like, that's literally, like, there's no explanation that they ever gave properly, I think, that really wrote off why he would suddenly change into a grown-up personality as well. Cut that one pretty close to the back end there. We're readjusting this a little bit because it's got to you know, we're a little off, and that's going to help
fix it. Don't worry, I'm not muttering anything important. I'm talking to myself. That one's not for you guys. That's for me trying to figure shit out. But I saw the Shazam trailer and I thought to myself, God damn! You know, the DCEU might have gotten the second one right. The first one was Wonder Woman. You know, I'll be honest. I'm not a hater of Batman versus Superman or the hater of Justice League. They're just not perfect. I don't even use the word perfect. They're just not awesome. They're good movies. I think they're okay, you know? Like, the problem is I don't want to spend money on an okay movie. So I get pissed off when I spend money on an okay movie when I want to spend money on a great movie. And again, that definition of greatness too is very pliable. It's not 100% in a single element here. You know what? I'm gonna quick do this because this should help us. I think I'm getting a little off angle on that. This should go straight up. Technically, I should go with, like, third perspective in this, and, like, it should actually go, like, three-point perspective, like, go up a little bit and narrow up towards the top. You know, just a little. That'll work a little better. It's like a little bonus. That's kind of a light one for you guys to see, but really, that's going to be, like, a line I'll end up tracing a few times, I think. For the most part, a lot of these guidelines here are good to go. We don't need to leave them here. I mean, they don't erase very easily, so I'm not really trying to. I'm just sort of like, okay, let's just take it down a little. I'm actually kind of happy with how much rolling we got done. What time is it? Yeah, it's about time to cut it. So, it's nearly 10 o'clock. So we're going to stop here tonight, but I'm looking at what you guys are looking at. I think you can see this has a pretty good shot. Tomorrow night, Monday, is always a short night. But if you think about what we have left, got some windows. Okay, not much, right? There's a window here, there's a window here. Lots of bush. Well, you've got bush. And then trees, tree. And again, I may not go very heavy into this tree's detail. I was getting down here and I'm like, you know what, this is not, it's getting to a mess. Like, it's gonna, I think, be easier for me to focus on like trying to figure out the branches real quick and then just throw leaves on top of it than try to sit here and try to work out all these leaf, you know, areas. I may change my mind by tomorrow. We'll see. If you've paid attention to this channel before, I don't know if you're here or not before. The stuff that I do, it's not really, there's not a whole lot of point to get super detailed in the sketches here because I'm just going to end up painting over it. You know what I mean? Like, it's very important to get the main lines down, major areas. Like, okay, I need to know where these boxes are. The plants that are in them, I'm improvised a little bit. I can see them. I can tell the colors of the main parts. So to try to draw all the little squiggles of what those plants will be is just going to waste my time. It's going to waste your time. Not worth it. You know, where the windows are over here and even kind of the idea of what I'm doing to the boards. That's kind of important.
Is it wildly important?
Probably not.
I do want to mark. It's right here. Yeah, that's a little dark area. You know, in every light there should be a little shadow. All right, but we got a lot of sky that we get to play around with. We got. Can you play around as much with the street? Because I'm not going to make it as reflective as it was, and because again, we didn't really want. Both Lou and I, as we were talking about, we don't want this necessarily to be a rainy day scene, you know? Like, one of the reasons he asked me to do this was because his wife was looking for something over this specific fireplace they have there, and they wanted something very, you know, farmy, you know, like for the area, something that fits. And they were looking, they'd find stuff with, like, a barn, but it's winter, and they didn't want the winter scene. They wanted something warmer. So to do this as a rainy summer day, like, I don't know if that's going to work as well. So we're going to get a little free when it comes to the area behind it. It's not going to be blue skies, per se. I think I'll keep cloudiness to it. But being rain clouds will be a little different. Like, I think I'll be a little more swirly, if you catch my drift. Like, very much more, I'm trying to think of, like a painting I can compare it to. I know what I'm doing, but let's put it that way. 9 times out of 10, I know what I'm doing. Sometimes I'm a lunatic, but, so I think we can get this hammered out, the drawing at least, finished tomorrow. Maybe one or two things will be carried over for, Wednesday. Wednesday's when I stream again. So tomorrow we'll try to finish the drawing up, maybe carry a little bit over for Wednesday. If I can, I want to get it done tomorrow, and then I'll spray it Tuesday, leave that off of the camera. You guys don't need to see that shit. Especially because I got to take this one all the way outside, so you won't see it anyway, really. And what else? Trying to think, but nothing happens. And then hopefully we can start the paint on Wednesday. I think that's a legitimate goal without any major issues. So guess that's it, guys. Guys and gals, should be specific. I don't know who's here. Yeah, anymore. The only girl I knew was a girl that was on here was somebody who was on my Facebook page, but she's not been on here for a while, so I don't know. And my cousin Jackie, but she hasn't been here tonight either. So, tomorrow night, Vince got karate. I come in, 9 o'clock-ish? Until about 10:30. And then Wednesday, it's usually 8 to 10:30, somewhere around there. So I got on early the last time, one of the days, and I actually seem to get more people that way. So I might try to get down here like 7:30. We'll see. And I'll get people before they're asleep, I guess. And that's about it. All right. So this is going to be a long one. I don't think it'll be as long as the fucking bridge was. Even though it's a bigger canvas, if you caught the bridge in Trevorin Farms, whatever how I pronounce it, there's so much green. On top of each other that had to be like worked out, and then the river caused me all sorts of trouble. I don't think it's gonna be that long, but it'll be a long one. I just don't think it's gonna be that long. So 2 weeks, maybe. Yeah. We'll see. It all depends on how much flow I can get into. Things been charging. My headphones been charging the whole time, so hopefully next time it'd be groovy.
What the fuck was that noise?
I got a mouse in here. Probably have a mouse in here. Whatever. So we'll see how quickly we can get grooving and moving on this. And like I said, a lot of it'll depend too. Once we get towards that end game, whether or not I feel like throwing in all these wires, because there's a shit ton of them off that one pole. Because out in this area, man, you got to run like everything everywhere. You only have so many poles. I'm not sure how much I'll do. Ugh. Excuse me. With that, I may just put the pole up and leave it there. Like, kind of take like damn it, who's the artist? There was a piece in the modernist exhibit that's going on at the Philadelphia Museum of Art. Well, they did a highway, and they made a point of mentioning that at this time when the person painted this painting, there were telephone poles and there was all sorts of shit, and there would have been cars there, but they just painted a road and the you know, grass by the road and then the trees, and that's all they painted. But if you go to that place, there's a lot more there than was in the painting. So I may take that type of attitude to it and just be like, you know what? These lines get in the fucking way. They block the house when I wanted to show the house. They block this. So I might make it a little more older and rustic. Part of me almost wants to take the telephone pole out entirely. And I could do that. I don't know. Maybe I'll run a poll or something on the Facebook page. See if anybody thinks it should stay or go. I mean, I don't know. The tree's there, though. You know what I mean? I'm just thinking that I like the idea of, like, this thing here in the middle, but at the same point, this goes all the way to the top. And I don't know if I want that, because then it's going to be like, here's a line. And you know what? I might take that out. I'll make that call tomorrow. So that this telephone pole may go. Because, again, it's my fucking painting. Yeah, it's Lewis Commission. It's my painting. And we'll talk about it from there. I just think it's going to get in the way. And the more and more I think about it, the more I think I got to cut that pole. And right now, there's not really... If we look at this picture... I'm going to show you the picture. That's not the picture. Like, if I cut along here, if you paid attention, if I took that out and just tried to fake my way through it, it's tree, 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 tree. Tree with a little bit of the barn behind it, right? What? The front end of a truck? I think I could fake that. Part of the camper, but behind the tree. You know, it's so much that tree's blocking everything back there anyway that I can kind of wipe this the fuck out. You know what? I think I'm doing that now. I'm just going to write it down. Like, no fucking thing there. What do we got? Trucks, front end... truck, goose. That's a little like thing down here. Okay, that's right. There's a little box or something down there. Might be like a little sandbox or something. Front end of the truck that, you know, goes to like here. Okay. So we can cut that. Well, technically that little car's like things being blocked by this thing. So I don't even see that. Right. Camper has a line here. That's the camper line there. I'm probably going to have to rewatch this myself at work just so I catch the end of it and make sure I remember what I parked. But, yeah, what I put there. But, yeah, I think that telephone pole's coming out. I don't like it. Oh, sir, I don't like it. Holy shit, I just realized how much Barack Obama sometimes sounds like the horse from, for instance, no, sir, I don't like it. Or maybe I'm confusing because I haven't watched Ren and Snippy in years. All right, I'm gone at this point, so have a good night, guys, and I will catch you tomorrow.